first chapter.
Hallelujah.
That's right there, the first one. The first
book.
Genesis, the third chapter. But I don't really feel preaching. Don't get left today.
All right.
Hallelujah. I know you got to warm up, but I'm back going, you know. Hallelujah.
All right.
Glory.
Yeah. Genesis, the third chapter.
Yeah.
And I'm going to begin reading at verse number 4.
Mm-hmm.
And if you will, keep your Bible open.
Yeah.
You don't know what that does. And keep the preacher honest.
Uh-huh.
It's just a good practice.
Yeah.
And I will refer to it. I'm not going to talk about what I'm going to talk about. We're going to be in the Word.
That's right.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Verse number 4 of the third chapter of the book of Genesis says, And the serpent said unto the woman, he ain't going to die for real. He said, not sure to die. For God does know. That in the day ye eat that of, then your eyes shall be open, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. When the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat. And gave also unto her husband with her. And he did eat. And just like the devil said, the eyes of them both were open. And they knew that they were naked. And they sold fig leaves together and made themselves some aprons. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. They heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? That word thou just means you. He asked him, where are you? And that's all I'm going to ask you. I believe I asked you before, but that's all I want to ask you today. Where are you?
All right.
Yes.
Where are you?
Yes, sir.
Seemingly a strange question to be asked by God. But if you really think about it, any question would be strange to be asked by God. Because the real record is that he knows everything.
Amen.
He is an all-knowing God. And he is an all-seeing God. The Bible says the eyes of the Lord. I ain't talking about long dim eyes, but the eyes of the Lord are in every. See, I can be looking right at you and don't see that. But the eyes of the Lord art in every place, beholding the evil as well as the good. And yet God asked Adam the question, where are you?
Amen.
My Lord.
There have been questions God have asked. He asked, what is this that you have done?
Right.
He asked, is there anything too hard for God? There are questions that God asks. Every question that God has ever asked, he always knew the answer.
Amen.
Other words, the asking of the question was not for the person who asked the question, but it was for the person who the question was asked. Don't answer. Most time when we ask a question, we're asking the question for our benefit so that we can find out the answer and then use it to the best of our interest. You understand that if I ask you, how do you get to the store? I'm not asking you so that you can see if you know. I'm asking you so that I know, that I know how to get there. But when God asks a question, you can rest assured. The purpose of God asking the question is so that you will be forced to think of an answer.
Amen.
And when God asked Adam, where are you? I think it would help us to look in the text and find out first and foremost, the book says that the Lord God placed Adam in the garden. So that he could tend or dress it and keep it. That's verse 15 in the second chapter. So the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And commanded him that of all the trees in the garden, he could freely eat. Except the tree that was in the midst, named and noted as the tree of knowledge of good and evil. He said, you shall not eat it.
Amen.
This is what God said. He says, for in it was conditional. In the day that you eat that up, you shall surely die. God placed the man in the garden. Did not move him from the garden. Left him for a short space of time. And comes back and asks the man, where are you? Now, sometimes what's important for us to understand is that when we talk about where we are, and most times if somebody asks us, where are you? Generally, they're talking about a physical location or a geographical location. In other words, if we are going to meet at the mall at 3 o'clock and it's 10 minutes after 3 and I don't see you nowhere, y'all ain't saying that. Like, it just makes sense for me to call you and ask you, where are you? Y'all ain't saying that. Because we were supposed to meet in a set place. And you were not where I expected you to be. I simply asked, where are you? But I want you to look at this from another standpoint today. And the only way to get this to make sense is that when we sometimes say, where am I? Or where are you? We're not talking about a physical location. We're not talking about a geographical location. But we're simply, you've heard folks say, I'm just not where I intended to be in life at this age. You understand that? What they're saying is I'm 50 and I'm still living at home with mama. Y'all ain't saying that. I'm still don't have no job and I still don't have a husband or a wife and I'm just not where I want to be.
All right.
Or they may at that moment when they say that, they might be setting up at a buffet in Golden Corral. Y'all understand that? Chances are they fat, that's exactly where they want to be. Y'all understand that? But what they're saying is that I'm not symbolically where I want to be at this stage in life. Sometimes, for most of us, it's easier to just not think about where we are.
Yeah.
You know, it has been said that when we're traveling, that men don't like to stop and ask for directions.
Amen.
Don't hear the preacher, you ain't got the amen that hard. Amen. And now, and most times when we done got lost, y'all ain't saying
yeah.
We don't like to say we lost.
Amen.
And our wife or girlfriend or whatever she is going to always say, just pull over at this door and ask somebody. But in our mind, we think we're almost right there. And if not, we feel like it's going to be another store up the street.
Amen.
And everybody that's sitting there, 20 miles later, you haven't seen your store. And you haven't seen nobody.
Amen.
Depending on where you're at, you might have seen somebody, but you didn't want to ask them.
All right. Yeah.
And we wind up just being lost. Y'all understand?
Amen.
And really what that's called is denial.
Yeah.
All right. And I think it's important. I go to Tallahassee quite a bit, and even just from here to Tallahassee, I can just about look at certain trees or anything, and almost tell by what mile marker I'm at. You know, just from having gone so many times.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I've gone that same route before. And was looking hard for a sign. Because it just seemed like it was taking forever to get there.
Uh-huh.
And sometimes in life you can doze off, you always say that. Or you can miss a turn, or you should have kept right and you veered to the left, or you should have gone left and you stayed right. And sometimes it's just good to be able to see signs along the way.
Yeah.
Amen. That will tell you whether you're on track or off track.
Uh-huh.
I remember some years ago, my brother was living in Shreveport, Louisiana, and I had just started driving. I had just got some old piece of license, and I was going to take my mother to see my brother in Louisiana. And that was a little trick you have to do on the road in Mobile.
Yeah.
Maybe you're familiar with that.
Yeah.
You get off of 65 over there, and you get on 98, and it swivel around. You don't stay on it long. It swivel around, and somewhere you pick up 49 or something like that down there.
Yeah.
And it was getting dark, and I thought I did it right.
Yeah.
And normally my mama, you know, if you're taking her somewhere, you do best to just let her drive. However you're going, ain't never the right way. But this night, she didn't say nothing. She kept making little grunts, but she didn't say nothing. And we had drove, I reckon, after we got off in Mobile, we had drove about an hour or so. And I saw a sign that said, flowing from 20 miles. And I probably couldn't go back and do what I did, you know, to figure out how I got where I was, but I wasted a whole lot of time thinking I was going right, when all the time I was going wrong. And not only that, if somebody had, we didn't have them GPS's then, if somebody had asked me the question, where are you? The side commentary is, I couldn't have even told them where I was. Some of us, see, I can admit that, but some of us live life just like that.
All right, all right.
We just ride.
Yeah.
We got it on cruise control.
Yeah.
Y'all ain't saying that. Some of us going slow and some of us are going fast. But yet we're still headed in the wrong direction. And the truth of the matter is, what made that so critical is that we had a goal place we were trying to get.
Yeah.
Y'all ain't saying. If the intent was just to go for a ride, it wouldn't have been so bad.
All right.
But we were trying to get to Shreveport.
Yeah.
Now we have wasted a tank of gas of a couple of hours trying to get where we're supposed to be, and we're just farther away than where we were trying to get. And I hear folk all the time who somehow got it in their mind that heaven is a different kind of place than what it really is. You understand that there are folks who think you can go in any direction and you're going to still wind up in heaven. I think while we're still alive, it's important to talk about that because we got a chance to correct that way of thinking. Y'all ain't saying that. And I don't understand why folk are thinking that, because every time somebody die, you know, we done put them in heaven and done give them their wings.
Yeah.
And that can be very confusing to folk, y'all ain't saying that, who are not in the church and don't understand.
Right,
because now the measurement of the logic becomes, well, if Bobo in heaven, I know I got some ecstasy and I can do it still get there.
Yeah.
You know, our mind says, either certain folk don't make it to heaven after what we know about them.
Now.
We don't have to put forth no power
else. All right.
Amen. My Lord.
I told you, you can, some places set up. You can get twisted around, and even in Pensacola, if you get on Highway 9, you can get turned all the way around. And just keep driving, and you'll stumble right up on what you were looking for. Heaven is not like that.
Amen.
You won't stumble up into heaven.
Amen.
It's a prepared place for a prepared people.
Amen.
And see, look at anybody want to go.
Yeah.
Nobody has been there. And nobody wants directions.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? We just think that I'm going to heaven anyhow.
Yeah.
Maybe I went to church a couple of times and that ought to be just enough. Maybe I quoted the son's prayer and that ought to be just enough. But the Bible says that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom.
Yeah.
So that says to me, you've got to have something besides flesh and blood. If you die and all you were was flesh and blood and had not received the Spirit of God, there's no way for you to inherit the kingdom of heaven. That's 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter. It says, flesh and blood cannot inherit.
Amen.
That's why we have to die.
Amen.
But in our text, the Bible says that after God had placed man in the garden, giving him specific instructions concerning the do's and don'ts. And now we act like God didn't give us no direction. We're doing just what Adam and Eve did. And we're figuring we can do how we want to because God is soft.
All right.
And God ain't soft is what you think.
All right, now.
The Bible said, be not deceived. That's Galatians, the 6th chapter. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man sow, that shall he also reap. You can fool me, but you can't fool God. You understand that? But the man was given specific instructions. God never told the man that the fruit on the tree didn't taste good.
Amen.
All right.
Y'all saw what I saw, didn't you? He never said that the fruit wouldn't get ripe.
All right.
He never said that it wouldn't fill you up. Never said that, as y'all can say, it tasted nasty.
My God.
But what he did say is that the day you eat off of it, you're going to die.
Surely
die.
We have come to accept some stuff.
Amen.
Even though it's poison, y'all ain't saying
right. Lord. Amen.
It tastes good.
Amen.
It gives us a good effect.
Uh-huh.
Y'all probably. We can get high off of it. Y'all like, it'll kill you now, but it is, never mind that.
Amen.
He said, the day that you eat out of the tree,
yes,
you're going to surely die.
Amen.
Sometimes when we think of things that folk have been poisoned with, rarely, if ever, do any of it taste good.
Right.
Amen.
But yet there is something about stuff that's not good for us. All y'all ain't saying
that. All right.
That drives us to want to try anyhow.
Yeah.
Some stuff I won't ever understand. You can't advertise it. You can't. They don't show crack commercials. Y'all ain't saying that. They don't have, not yet, they don't have marijuana advertisements. They don't tell you we got the best fire over here. Y'all ain't saying that. But yet you can always find some folks who are looking just for that. How about what I'm saying is that there are things that they've advertised and they talked about how good it is on the commercial.
Yeah.
Folk have talked about how good it is and you won't ever fool with that.
Amen.
But the stuff that they can't talk about.
All right.
Stuff you got to get in the corner and buy.
Y'all
ain't saying that. I'm just convinced anything I got to buy and hide from you, I already know something wrong with
that. Amen. Amen.
God placed the tree in the middle of the garden.
Yes, he did.
Told the man, don't eat off of this tree.
Yes.
Amen.
But God was still a generous God.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Because he said, of all the other trees,
my Lord.
You can freely eat.
Oh, yes.
Except the one tree.
Mm. Mm.
You know what I want you to understand this, and the reason why I'm going to talk about it, I may not get no higher, but the reason I want to talk about it is because every time you hear a real word of God, the devil has something to send in your ear that counters what God's real word is.
Amen.
They were not told by somebody what God wanted, because that could have been some confusion. I sent messages and they got sent wrong. So it could have been some misunderstanding, but God told the man himself. And still the man allowed the devil to come and tell them, God, I know what God told them. I knew God was going to say that. He done told y'all can't eat off all the trees. God, hold it back on you. Look at this. And sometimes we got this mindset that God didn't do this. He didn't give me that. So I don't owe him a praise. The praise ain't contingent on whatever else he gives you. God has already blessed you more than you deserve. He's already blessed me more than I deserve. God doesn't do anything else for you. If you allow mama and daddy to die, if you allow you to lose your job, if you allow you to go to the hospital, God is still wearing it and he's still already doing it.
Amen.
I think we think it feels good for God to be on one side love affair. To gobble up all the goodness of God. And then let anybody's word be enough for us to not worship him. Every excuse we can find. The church folk ain't no good. The preacher ain't no good. These ain't no good. How good have you ever been? I understand. Right now you're saying the church, those people, the deacons, them church, they all phonies and they all show us how to be real. At what point were you real enough to say that since somebody else is not real, you're not going to do what you're supposed to do?
All right.
Nobody goes on the job You'll complain about it, but you're not going to last long on the job talking about you ain't going to do nothing because they didn't do
nothing.
No God will accept that as an excuse.
Amen.
I ain't going to work hard because they don't work hard.
Amen.
I ain't going to come in because they don't come in.
Yes.
With that, you're not going to have a job very long.
Amen.
The devil comes and tell the woman,
Yeah,
God holding out on you. Some of us got that mindset, he owes us.
Amen.
If you give me this job, then I go to church. You know how to cut deals, man.
Yes.
If you do this, then I do that. Rather than just, if you would just do it the other way and just tell God thank you for what he's already done.
Yes.
Give God praise for what he's already done. Bless his name for what he's already done. You can't put no ransom on God.
Amen.
You can't hold God hostage.
Yeah.
Amen.
So the Bible says, the devil said to the woman, the Lord just trying to fool you now.
Yeah.
Amen.
And said, he know that the day that you eat off of that tree, that your eyes are going to come open. And that you're going to be like God with a little G. Now God created man in his image.
Yeah.
And in his likeness. So we were already like God. Y'all ain't saying. And the devil said that God just don't want you to eat off of the tree so you don't be like God.
All right.
Okay.
It's bad when the devil no more worried than you know.
Yes,
because he got a way of twisting the word around.
Yes.
He got a way of making you believe God said something God didn't say.
All right.
He got a way of making you believe somebody else said something they didn't say. The devil is tricky with words.
Yeah.
Y'all ain't saying that. He'll take that word play and he'll make a real big deal out of it.
Yeah.
He said that your eyes are going to be open.
Yeah.
And you'll be like God, knowing good and evil.
My Lord.
Now listen, the sad part about this is they already knew good.
Right.
Amen.
Don't you tell me it ain't good to be created and given life and given everything you need.
Yeah.
Did you hear what I said? Be given everything you need.
Amen.
No need for food, no need for shelter, no worrying about fighting, no worrying about heartaches, no worrying about pain and suffering. You tell me you don't know good?
Hallelujah.
But the devil says that God knows that you're going to know both good and evil. And we can be sold on some silly stuff. Y'all ain't saying
that.
Because if you already know good, you ought not seek to find evil.
Amen.
Some of us have done just that. God have set us up just right.
Yeah.
God have blessed us so good. And it's just something about evil that sparks our curiosity. It's just something about it that makes us, I know it's wrong. It don't even seem right from the start. I don't even really want to do it, but it's just something inside of me telling me to try, just try and try.
Yeah.
Jesus. You already knew good.
Amen.
Other words, you knew. You were given a job.
Amen.
With enough money to pay your bills.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
But that wasn't enough for you. You wanted to go where they was going. Y'all right, sir.
All right.
Not thinking about the fact that when they go, they be broke.
Yeah.
Amen.
You wanted to do what they were doing. Not realizing that when they do what they do, they are depressed. Y'all ain't saying it. When they do what they do, they don't have no peace. They don't have no joy. They don't have no satisfaction and no happiness. And yet, after God has blessed us, we still got to try.
All right. Amen.
Jesus. Notice now. The devil said, the God just humbled you. You ain't going to die for real. You're not going to literally die.
Yeah.
Only thing going to happen is this. God's going to come over. Now the devil didn't lie about that because the scripture says that after they ate of the fruit, well, their eyes came over.
Yeah.
And they looked at each other and saw that they were naked.
Yeah.
Now let me tell you something. They were naked before they ate the fruit.
Yeah.
All right.
And wasn't nothing wrong with being naked
yeah.
at that time.
Yeah.
But sin causes guilt, and that's a good thing. The problem is when sin causes guilt rather than deal with the cause of the guilt. Y'all ain't saying that. Rather than deal with the cause of the sin, we rather either point the finger or, in other words, just find somebody who works for us.
Amen.
So the Bible says when they saw that they were naked, they were ashamed. We had everything we need. A healthy relationship with God. Access to a living God. Food and water. And everything they needed. And yet they disobeyed God. At the word of the devil. The Bible said when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat and gave also to her husband with her. And he did eat. So after God had said it would cause death, the devil says you won't die for real. I know sometimes you hear one thing in your left ear and something different in your right. But the book says let God be true. And every man a liar. There's a discrepancy on what's right and what's wrong. Rest assured that God's word is always right. Rest assured that whatever God says, it is going to come to pass. And if God says that you're going to die, rest assured that you're going to die. If God says that he don't like something, I don't care who else likes it.
I don't care
who else goes along with you. Y'all ain't saying it. I don't care who else wants to be acceptable. Then God just doesn't like it. And ultimately, the judge, the final judge, is going to be God. You understand that? And just because he didn't allow you to drop dead when you sinned. Y'all ain't saying that. Just because you didn't fall dead when you cheated. Just because you didn't fall dead when you sinned against God doesn't mean that you're not going to die. Just because he's still allowing you to go on about life every day does not mean that God is satisfied. But the scripture says it is appointed shut once unto men to die. And then after death comes the judgment. And the book says every man, every woman, and boy and girl, even after you die, gonna be raised from the dead to give an account of your sin. In our text, the book says that is God deferred judgment. He didn't come in rashness or in haste. But the Bible says he waited until the cool of the day. Otherwise, God controlled the day. So God waited until he cooled down. Isn't that a good God? I'm glad he didn't come and get me and as soon as I mess up, I'm glad. Cause I done some stuff that I'm not so proud of. But I'm happy that he didn't destroy me while I was in my mess. But the God we serve, he's a merciful God. He'll still wake you up in the morning in hopes that this will be the day that you'll realize that I've messed up. He said, not bold of you to continue to sin against God just because he didn't call you into judgment. Should not mean he's happy with what you're doing. But you ought to think about what God asked Adam. Adam, where are you? You ought to put your own name there and ask yourself, where are you? You ought to just think about where God put you. God knew that he put him in the garden. God knew exactly where he left him. But God wanted Adam to see you're not where I left you. For when I left you, we were in good standing. When I left you, you had everything you needed. When I left you, I could depend on you. When I left you, I could trust in you. When I left you, there was nothing between us. But going into revival, all of us ask ourselves, I feel like Teddy Pendergrass said, is it still good today? You still remember when the Lord first saved you, when you first heard his word and first heard about God. Some of them been there when you had the fire. Some way, somehow, you started listening to the devil. And when you listen to the devil and rationale with the devil, when you reason with Satan, he's not your friend. The devil is your enemy. He's an enemy. He's a sworn enemy to the real God and everybody that name the name of God. Is to step out on the long side. When you live for God, the devil is your enemy. I'm gonna tell you what Jesus said in John 10 and 10. The thief comes, but for to kill, to steal, and destroy. If you see the devil coming, you ought to take off running. If you hear him talking in your ear, you ought to tell. Just look back. We know we've had more. than what we have right now. We know it's been better. We've had some better days. We know that was a time when the Lord took good care of us and we didn't have no problem. But now the devil and fooled us. No joy, no peace, no satisfaction. And God is saying, you ought to look at where you are. You ought to look at where you are. And ask the Lord, Father, forgive me. I have sinned. Ask the Lord to restore you, make you whole again. You ought to ask the Lord, Father, I stand by you. No other help I know. Who had a rich father and a healthy inheritance. One day he listened to the devil. He seen the good life. He knew what it was like having everything you needed. He knew what it was like having servants to work on me. He knew what it was like to have more than enough food. He knew what it was like to dress as well as you wanna. But what did he know? But what it was like to get hunger? My God. But he didn't know what a liar was being without a friend. What did he know about? So he came at the direction of the devil. Yeah. I told his dad. So let me tell you something, when the devil influences you, you don't care who you have. And I don't say what the book says, but I'm gonna tell you what it means. Daddy, I know I got a big inheritance coming. But some way, somehow, you're living too long.
All right.
Now, I don't wanna kill you, so. Just go ahead and give me my inheritance now. Let me see what it's like to live.
Amen.
You know there are people who can't wait to get on their own. I want to see what it's like to live by myself. Well, you can watch whatever channel you want on the TV. That's if you got money to pay the cable bill. You can go in whatever room you want. When you're under the influence of the devil, you don't care who feelings you have. Hallelujah. The daddy gave him all his money.
Yes, dear.
Because the daddy already knew. See, that's why you be a child before you become a daddy. So as a daddy, you know what the child about to go through. As a mama, you've already been a child. I know sometimes children think parents don't know nothing. You know, we just got parents like this. We just grew up like this. And the dad already knew what would happen. Give him all this stuff. And that's a whole nother sermon, but I just, you know about it.
My God.
The book says he went over a fox. You know what we were saying. When I get grown, I'm going to get fired out of here. From my mom. She made us go to church. And when I get grown, I ain't looking to church. And I ain't going to make my children go either. And now they're 13 and 14.
Yeah.
And you're around here talking, what's wrong with these children? We wasn't like that. You even forgot about mama was carrying you to church. They will put some word on you. They will put some prayer on you. They will put some anointing on you. I'm a praying for you. I don't know who to pray for. I don't even know who you are.
Amen.
He had taken her, went far as he could from daddy.
Yeah.
The book says he went in a foreign land.
Oh.
And you know that means he went somewhere he didn't know nothing about.
Right.
And where they didn't know nothing about him.
Uh-huh.
Some folk can't wait.
Yeah.
That's why some folk die young, they can't wait.
Yeah.
You trying to make up all them days you wanted to smoke. Y'all ain't smoking. You trying to make up all of them in one day.
Yeah.
You trying to make up all the days you wanted to drink. You know? You trying to drink it all in one day.
Yeah.
He went to the fire land.
Yeah.
Before they had internet. Before they had email.
Yeah.
Long off shop distance.
Yeah.
He went in a foreign land. The Bible said when he got there, at first it was like it was at home.
Oh, yeah.
You understand, since he had a lot of money, he had a lot of friends.
Yeah.
And you know, as long as you buy rounds for everybody,
yeah.
Y'all ain't saying that.
Yeah.
As long as they telling you the life of the Father,
yeah.
As long as you're not still kind of fit. As long as they know you still got something.
All right.
You always got a so-called friend.
Yeah.
But I doubt you to get broke.
Right.
Everybody you know.
Yeah.
They broke even on their check day. Y'all ain't
my Lord.
Amen.
How soon folks forget?
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Hey. And it wasn't no different for this man.
Yeah.
He got on there. This morning, oh shit, he got on there drinking and partying,
yeah.
And messed around and went broke.
Oh yes, he did.
Mm-hmm. And he still didn't consider where he was.
Amen.
But the Bible said, day by day, little by little, he got a little broken.
Yeah.
And the book said he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country.
Amen.
And they hired him to go work in the hog pen.
Yeah.
The shucks. And while in the hog pen one day, the book said he got so hungry.
Yeah. Yeah.
Won't that happen to you?
Oh, yeah.
We outside the will of God. He got so hungry.
Yeah.
The Bible says the slop started to look good. The hog almost, as y'all could say, was scarred. Yes. He got so hungry.
Yeah.
Until he just about ate some of the hog slops. But then the book says, what? He came to himself.
Yeah.
And asked himself, where am I?
Uh-huh.
Where did I start out?
Yeah.
And how did I get here?
Amen.
The reason I know he analyzed it because the book said he asked himself, how many house servants? My daddy got back home with more than enough food to eat.
Yeah.
And here I telling him about the die from hunger. About to eat the hog slop. He asked himself, where am I? Then he said, I know what I'm gonna do.
All right.
I'm gonna get up. I like that because that's all you have to do. Doesn't matter where you are right now. If you realize and recognize,
yes, sir.
I'm out of bounds.
Yes, sir.
I'm offside.
Yeah.
I'm out of place.
Yeah.
I'm trespassing.
Yes,
I'm not where I'm supposed to be. But you recognize you're out of the will of God. You can do like the man. Come to yourself and tell yourself. He said, how many sailors? I ain't talking about what my daddy got.
Uh-huh.
I tried the jokers that worked for my daddy.
Yeah.
Got more than enough.
Amen.
I believe I'm going back home.
Amen.
And he said, I'm going to tell my father, Lord, I was done wrong.
Yeah.
I'm not worth it. He will be called your son.
Amen.
And I know I got to earn your trust.
Yeah.
This is what he said he was going to tell his dad.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to tell him, just make me a high servant.
Yeah.
You ain't got to call me to
glory. All right.
You ain't got to own me as your child.
Yeah.
But just let me come back as one of your workers.
Yeah.
But the Bible says, as the boy made his way back home, you know that's what I love about God.
Yeah.
When you recognize and come to your
Lord.
Self, and you come to look for God,
yeah.
He's also looking for you.
Yeah.
The Bible was on his way back home. Have speak together for
him. Yeah.
But coming up to here, his father looked down to him,
Lord.
And his son said, you're come, my son. It doesn't matter what you've done.
All right.
Doesn't matter your sin.
Hallelujah.
The reason they told us about the prodigal son was so we could understand the position that God has.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He knows what you've done, but he's still watching for you. He's still waiting for you to just say, I'm sorry. He said, repent, every one of you, and be baptized. You gotta recognize that God didn't wrong you, but you wrong God. But God is such a loving God. He still said, come unto me. I'm here later, and I have it later, and I'll give you life. Toward God. Tell maybe you're here. And you let the devil fool you. Maybe you're here. And the devil have driven you out of bounds. Maybe the devil have driven you to a point of no return. It's a good day and a good time to come to yourself. Realize and recognize the goodness of God. And God will receive you even now.
Thank you.
The door is open.
Amen.
It's a good day.